Sometimes we say the temples of the Hare Krishna movement are like embassies of the spiritual world. So do you feel like you're entering a different space, isn't it, when you come here? It's amazing. It's like, I remember years ago we used to go for, you had to go to the India office to get visas to go to India. So it's like you're in the middle of winter in London and in the India visa office there's a fan on the top. And you think, why is there a fan here, you know? It's interesting, when you go in the visa office, it's almost as though you've already entered that country, you know? No one queues up in the visa office. None of the machines work. All the counter people are chewing like pan. You know, so it's, but when you come into a spiritual place, it's almost as though you feel a different energy, you feel a different atmosphere. And the manor is very special because for over, yeah, this is the 50th year. So for 50 years, there's been so much spirituality going on here on a day-to-day basis. So I hope you'll have a wonderful experience here. How many of you are here for the first time ever? Oh, wow. Okay, so the others have been. So yeah. So it's your home. You're welcome to come anytime. And yeah, just to add a footnote to what Sundar Madhava said, I think he's very generous. I'm by no means a perfect specimen. Just a work in progress, but over the past decades, I've had the fortune to learn from so many amazing teachers, and I guess what we're trying to share here today is just what we've learned from our teachers. So, yeah, if there's anything good that comes out, it's from what I learned from the teachers, and if there's anything a bit suspect, that's probably me. But yeah, so feel free as we converse to be open, to be relaxed. There's no judgment here. Any question you want to ask, if you want to challenge, that's also good. You won't win, I'll beat you. No, but if you don't. No, but we want you to challenge, and we're just here, we're friends having an open discussion. So just to set that mood before we go on, so yeah.
So I think I'll get the ball rolling, and in the course of the conversation, I mean, if anyone wants to say anything, it's not a school, you can just, you know, just go for it, feel at home. So Maharaj, I was wondering, a lot of these are meeting you for the first time. Can you tell us something about yourself, how you got involved in all of this?
Which one do you want, the good, the bad, or the ugly? Just very, very short, because I'm sure some of you, I don't think I'm meeting all of you for the first time. I sense I've met some of you before, but just very, very short. I grew up in Wembley, not too far away from here. The Bhagavad Gita explains that we're all continuing our spirituality from a previous life. So it's not that here you are beginning your journey now, you're kind of carrying on from where you left off from. So I guess when I was about 15 or 16, just questions started popping up in my heart about life, about the future, about suffering in the world. I was very fortunate to grow up in a background where, like, materially it was quite good, comfortable, had everything. But still I felt like there was more to life. So at the age of 15, I started looking into spiritual things, and I picked up the Bhagavad Gita. And yeah, that's where my journey began. When the first time I picked up the Bhagavad Gita, I just had to put it down after about 3 minutes because it all just went like vroom, like over my head. This is too complex. But I continued studying, questioning. Then I went to university. I studied at UCL in London. I studied management. And through my university years, my spiritual hunger was growing. And when I graduated, I had to have an ominous conversation with my parents, who had invested tens of thousands of pounds into my education. And I had to tell them, I'm not going to get a graduate job. Instead, I'm going to go to India for a year because I need to travel and I need to explore. So naturally, my parents were a little nervous. My dad said, religion, don't go too deep because religion has no end. You'll never come out. I said, don't worry, dad, I'm a balanced guy. then I ended up like this. So he sensed there was something there, but I convinced them. Anyway, then I went to India and I traveled around, and it was an incredible journey. Because in India, and spiritual India, let me say spiritual India, because India has a lot of things in it. But spiritual India taught me a whole different way of living, a whole different value system, a whole different purpose and goal. And so when I came back, I decided, yeah, let me pursue this. So I came and I lived here when I was 21. That was in 2002. And yeah, 1 year became 2, which became 5, which became 10, which has now been over 20 years. And yeah, and then recently I entered like another phase of my life where I accepted a vow called sannyas. So nowadays we walk around with one of these sticks. It's good for self-defense, amongst other things. But the sticks represent, there's 3 sticks in there, and they represent the body, mind and words. So when you take a vow of sannyas, then you try to make a vow that for the rest of your life you'll remain as a monk, and try to dedicate your body, mind and words to sharing spirituality. So that's what I'm trying to do, imperfect as I am. And so, yeah, this is, I guess, what we're doing here today is what I do every day, which is just meeting people and discussing life and trying to help each other understand more about where we can find real happiness. So I think that's a little bit about me.
Yeah, yeah. Wonderful. Yeah. Thank you. I think some of them here may be interested in taking sannyas one day.
So, not looking at anyone.
What's a typical day in your life like living here at the temple?
Yeah, early mornings are really important. So it begins very early. The hours before sunrise are said to be the most powerful hours of the day to spiritually connect. So we're usually up by 3. And if you're kind of a little bit lazy, then you're up by 4. And the first service of the day, what we call aarti, which is in the temple room, is at 4:30. And yeah, we sing. Then between 5 and 7, we do our own personal meditation. And then at 7, we kind of have someone in the community who reads from one of the books of wisdom. And then we have a discussion. And that takes us up to breakfast. So it's amazing you've done so many things before breakfast. And then during the day, we do all do different things. So there's so many things to do at the temple. We have our farm. We have schools that visit. And then many of us go out into the world, whether it be universities, colleges, corporate firms. And sometimes we just stand on street corners, as Sundar and myself did for some years, stopping people and just talking to them about spiritual things, which is an interesting experience. So yeah, we do different things. And then we come back in the evening, and we usually have some milk in the evening, and try to wind down. And yeah, most of the monks are in bed they don't have a bed actually, they sleep on the floor in the sleeping bag. By about 9 o'clock, and then get about 6 hours sleep, which is sufficient. And then the day begins again. Simple living, high thinking. That's the motto.
Smith was there nodding. Like, yeah. Why a monk? I mean, people may think, you know, what about football? What about restaurants? What about cinema? You know, all these things in life that people do for entertainment and for fun. Do you feel like you're missing out by doing what you're doing?
Yeah, all these things are naturally pleasurable. Like, who's not going to say there's no happiness in going on holiday to the Maldives or something? Of course, it's nice, you know. And it's not that you can't do that. You can watch a film now and again, no problem. It's not the end of the world. But it's kind of like this. You can be the top of Division 2, but you're still in Division 2. So all of these things, they might give you some pleasure in a certain league of happiness, But when we start entering the spiritual wisdom literatures, then we start interacting with a different league of happiness, what we call the Premier League of happiness. And so when you start interacting with that, a kind of happiness, a fulfillment, which goes beyond the body, which goes beyond the mind, which goes beyond temporary pleasures, and you begin contacting something much more profound, then what happens is that all of the other things which previously, yeah, your life was kind of rotating around, those things don't hold as much interest anymore. And so when people come to spiritual life, it's not like we're forcing ourselves, like, okay, now I've got to make sure I don't do this and I've got to make sure I don't do that. But it's kind of like you experience something which is of such a higher grade quality that you begin looking at the other things and you think, like, I could do it, but I could be spending my time doing bigger and better things. And so I think it's kind of like that. Krishna says in a very beautiful verse, just to give you a little bit of taste of Sanskrit, because you've all been studying. Krishna says in a very beautiful verse, Vishaya vinivartante niraharasya dehina rasovarjam rasopyasya paramdrishtva nivartate. Krishna says everyone is looking for rasa. Rasa means an experience. But Krishna says there's a lower experience and there's a higher experience. And once you've experienced the higher thing, you kind of give up the lower one pretty automatically. And so.
Okay. Wonderful. At this point, anyone here got any questions that you wanted to? You're looking a bit reserved and a bit shy. I think it's just going to take one question. From
yeah, one question to break the ice and then we'll be flowing.
What is the higher thing than becoming a monk?
What's the higher? There's nothing higher than becoming a monk. No, actually, becoming a monk, you know, when I became took the vow of sannyas, then many people came to me, they congratulated me. And I kind of was telling people that I don't actually see it as an achievement. I don't think being a monk is an achievement. I don't think being a monk is the goal of life. I don't think being a monk signifies success. The goal of life is to develop love in your heart and a service or a spirit of serving selflessly. So if you're a householder and you learn that spirit of how to selflessly serve the people around you, how to selflessly serve society, that life becomes the most beautiful life. If as a monk you learn how to serve and give, help other people to find happiness, peace, then your life as a monk becomes successful. So the highest thing in life is not to become a monk. The highest thing in life is not even to get married. The highest thing in life is to develop the love, the selflessness by which we function in this world, taking ourselves out of the center. Because when we give, then we receive an amazing fulfillment within ourselves. So the highest thing in the world is service.
And that we can do in any of the fields that we are.
Yeah. You got you as a householder, you can serve. If you have children, serve them. If you're working in the world, then through your work, find out how you can contribute and make the world a better place. Whatever you're doing, just do it in a spirit of service. So, and that's really what the Bhagavad Gita is all about. So it's not that spiritualists don't own anything; it's that spiritualists aren't owned by anything. So you can live in this world, you can function in this world, but use it for a higher purpose than just selfish gain.
So just on that then, you know, you said you've been serving here now for over 20 years. What keeps you going? What inspires you to want to give and to be that selfless and to develop that love? How do you sustain for so long?
I think every day we see amazing transformation within people. Every day we see stories of how when people come in contact with spirituality, their life changes. And so every day when we're experiencing these miraculous things by sharing spirituality with the world, you almost wake up the next day and you think, wow, what's going to happen today? What amazing, miraculous, mystical, memorable, moving thing will happen today? So for me, like, spirituality and this type of life, a life in which we're trying to give, is full of so many adventures, is full of so much excitement, is full of, just beautiful experiences. When I joined the monastery, someone said to me, you have two choices. Either you can fill your life with things to show, or you can fill your life with stories to tell. Which one do you want to do? You want to fill your life with things to show people, or you want to fill your life with stories to tell people of amazing, mystical, beautiful things that happened? And so it's such a beautiful life when we become givers that there's so many amazing stories and adventures on a day-to-day basis. So sometimes people think a monk, no, don't do this, don't do that. It feels like a very restrictive life. Actually, it's the greatest adventure. It's just a beautiful, mystical drama every day.
Anybody else? I've got one actually. So what challenges do you face, if you do face any, and do you as a monk get distracted?
Do I as a monk get distracted? Do I as a monk go through any difficulties? Well, you know, when you connect yourself to or you do your ECG, your echocardiogram, right? Echocardiogram. Then how does the lifeline go? It's always like this, isn't it? If your lifeline is like that, that's bad news, my friend. That's not good news. Life means ups and downs. Life means difficulties. Life means success and failure. So whether you're a monk, whether you're a householder, everyone has ups and downs in their life. There are good days, there are bad days, there are challenges that appear. But what happens is that when we take up spirituality, we have a lens through which to see everything. It's not that you don't face problems anymore, but now you have a lens through which to see those problems, and therefore you can turn the problem into an opportunity. When you become spiritual, it's not that you have relationship difficulties anymore, but now you have a lens. Who are they? Who am I? What's the purpose of this interaction? And therefore we can rise above the ego and interact with people in a different way. So yes, there are challenges. There are difficulties with the mind, difficulties with our senses, difficulties with determination. There are doubts. There are relationship strains. So many problems. But we learn to see that each of those challenges are an opportunity to grow. Because no pain, no gain. So pain has a purpose. Problems open up the doors for progress. And so, we just learn that art of how to turn pain into purpose. And in the challenges, we grow, and therefore they don't overwhelm us.
Can I ask a question? It's mainly around detachment, and just reminded me when you mentioned that word. I think when I first read Bhagavad Gita, I was thinking about that concept quite a lot when I was a bit younger, and I basically concluded that it'd be very difficult to live a life in detachment. You have responsibilities and senses and other things happening. And then when I did the Discover course, I think it was mentioned that, and maybe when I read the Gita again, that by attaching everything through Krishna, you can almost detach.
Mm-hmm.
Is that correct in terms of the way I'm thinking about it?
Yeah. I'll tell you a story. Once there were two monks and they were crossing the river, celibate monks, an old monk and a young monk. And just as they were about to cross the river, there was a lady there. And she was kind of struggling to cross the river. So she called out to the two monks. She said, "I need help. I can't cross the river. My child's on the other side and I need your help too." They were celibate monks. So the young monk kind of looked. It was like, "Sorry, saffron." No can do. The old monk, he walked up to the lady and he put her on his shoulders. And he carried her across. The young monk was like, anyway, the young monk then swam across, the lady went her way, and the two monks carried on walking, and the young monk, he just couldn't get out of his mind that you're a celibate, you're a lifetime renunciate, how could you carry a woman on your, you know? And so he couldn't hold himself. After a moment, after some time, he just opened his mouth and he said to the old monk, "How could you carry her?" And you know what the old monk looked at him and said? The old monk said, "I carried her for 5 minutes on my shoulders for the purpose of service. But you've carried her in your mind for hours for the purpose of fault finding." The old monk taught the young monk a lesson that detachment is not an external thing. Detachment is an internal thing. And therefore, you can be surrounded by wealth. You can be surrounded by possessions. You can be in the most influential positions in the world. And you can be the greatest renunciate. If you use all of those things for service. So, by all means. Detachment is not just about walking away from everything, but it's about detaching yourself from the spirit that everything is for me, my enjoyment, my glorification, my aggrandizement. No, everything you have is for service. Does that make sense? When you say paths, you mean different religions?
Different religions or different sects.
There are so many different religions in the world, and even within the Vedic tradition, there are so many different paths. So why this path? Why Hare Krishna? They had the best food. That's part of the reason. Well, let me just, as a precursor to that question, let me just say that according to the Vedic teachers, all of the religions of the world and the variety of paths, even within the Vedic traditions, if they're followed with sincerity, with purity, it's not that someone can't achieve God consciousness. They can. Some of my best friends are Muslims. Some of my best friends are Christians. And I find them to be highly spiritual and highly close to God. And I learn many things from them. So I guess the first thing we would sit here and say is that we don't have a monopoly on spirituality. But then you may say, naturally, that why this one then? Why didn't you become another part of another path? I think our conception of spiritual traditions and religions is that there's a unity in diversity. So there's a unity in the sense that they're all talking about similar things. But there's a diversity in the sense that they have different levels of detail. They have different levels of evolution in their revelation of theology. And so when I began, I studied many different religious paths, and when I began reading the Vedic traditions, the Bhagavad Gita and the other corollary literatures around it, it kind of I just began to see a level of detail, a level of comprehensiveness, a level of advancement of theology that I didn't see in other places. And then one devotee kind of explained it to me. He said there could be many dictionaries, and you could have a pocket dictionary and you could have the Cambridge dictionary, and they're both right and they're both useful and they're both equally relevant in the world, yet this one has more detail. And so I think when we take a step back and look at all of the different revelations and we assess it on objective measures, at least from my analysis, my conclusion was that I've never experienced anything as advanced and as detailed as this. And therefore I began pursuing it. So that was one aspect of why I took up Krishna consciousness. But I don't think that's what kept me in it. I think after that initial sense that this is really evolved, what really kept me in it is just transformation and experience. I was like practicing this stuff, I was like, whoa, this stuff works. Like they say you do this and this happens and you kind of experience it. You change as a person, your qualities evolve, your character changes, your relationships, your vision. And that was like amazing. So, yeah, I would say the two things that convinced me about this particular, path was the philosophy and the practice, both.
Anybody else?
Yeah. I thought you guys were going to have some challenging questions for me. Oh wow. If you had to do it all over again, what would you change? I did a talk recently called 4 Mistakes I Felt I Made in My Life. And I'll just share the first one with you because I think that's something I would do differently. I felt as though early in my spiritual journey, for the first 10 years of my spiritual life, I was on kind of my own journey, but I didn't really take that much help from other spiritual people on the journey. I was kind of friends with them, I would talk with them, we would have discussions, but I never really took like personal coaching from them or personal kind of inspiration or advice from them. I was kind of a very individualistic person. I kind of created a little bit of a bubble around me whereby I wouldn't really let people into my life. And sometimes there's good reasons why we do that. But then what happened is after a certain amount of time in my spiritual journey, I realized I think I've only gone so far as I can go now. To get to another level of experience, I need to take help from those who have ventured into higher levels of spiritual experience. And when I opened myself up to let others into my life who could help me, coach me, guide me, then I found that I achieved a certain acceleration in my journey that just took me to places that I never thought I could reach. And so if I could do it all over again, I think I would let people into my life earlier and take help. Because I think when you let people help you, then you kind of discover a potential within you that you never knew was there. Of course, in this day and age, we're very skeptical about taking help from other people because we've been let down, because people have abused our faith. They say in this day and age, followers question everything and leaders do questionable things. So there's this high skepticism that, no, I'm going to do it myself. Like, I don't need any help. I'm going to make it. But it's actually a beautiful thing to let people in your life to open up new worlds for you. So I guess that's one thing I would change. Yeah. Yes. Dreams, yeah. Could do a whole seminar on dreams, actually. There's one of our spiritual leaders who actually talked about dreams and psychic phenomena and, yeah, what dreams can tell you about your life and your direction. Well, personally, I never remember my dreams. I just kind of knock out and wake up and I'm just like, oh my God. I have dreams, but I can't usually remember them. So I can't say personally I've had any kind of direction in dreams. Yeah, sometimes we say dreams are an amalgamation of your experiences in the material, in the real material world. And therefore, sometimes dreams are just like mental energy, which are being replayed in the subconscious. But there are also said to be spiritual dreams. Yeah, that... divinity and divine people, they almost exist beyond time-space barriers and they can communicate in more subtle ways. And so, yeah, in spiritual traditions, we often hear about people who have dreams and that's giving them some message, some guidance, some inspiration. It's possible, yeah. Even Srila Prabhupada, when he decided to take the order of being a full-time, a long, lifelong renunciate, he said the trigger was a dream from his spiritual teacher who came to him and said, you should do this. But interestingly, he said he had to have the dream three times before he took it seriously. So that's an interesting thing, because also we shouldn't take our dreams like just at face value, because sometimes it can just be mental energy. So if you feel like you have a dream which is coming, which is spiritual, which has some higher direction, what we recommend people to do is just check it with other spiritual people who you trust and see what their take on it is and whether it's something you should pursue.
Like you may have a slight regret and you could have done something else instead, like become a lawyer or something else.
Become a lawyer. Definitely not become a lawyer. Never trust a lawyer. No, I'm only joking. If I'm honest with you, I don't have any regrets. I feel like, yeah, I walked into the right life. I feel like I'm in my element. I feel like in this life, I can not only develop my own spirituality, but I can make a contribution to the world, which is very much needed, insignificant as I am. But I think, yeah, it's... there's always opportunity cost. I don't know, if I turn the clock back, I did a management degree, maybe I could have gone into the city, maybe I could have been successful in that material way and changed the world in a different way. Could, maybe it could have happened. But it just didn't feel right for me. It didn't resonate with me. And one thing I'll just share with you, which is a side point. In life, there are many voices around us, voices of expectation, voices of pressure, whether that be your family, whether it be your friends, whether it be society, whether it be the media. And it's not that those voices and those sounds and those expectations are necessarily bad. But what can sometimes happen is that all of that noise drowns out your inner voice, your inner calling. And I think so many people in the world don't hear their inner calling because they're just drowned out by the noise of so many expectations around them. And so I think what gives me confidence that my path was the right path is because I think I took time to hear all of the voices of expectations around me, but also hear my own voice and do a comparison and do an analysis and then make a decision based on that. Whereas I think if I had not followed this calling, I may have just done something out there based on what people wanted me to do. So I don't have any regrets. And I think no one in their life will have regrets if you make time and space to hear your inner calling and not just follow the path that the world has told you is the path. Because maybe there's another path for you. How do you know you're being sincere in something?
Yeah.
I think sincerity is made up of three components: intention, attention, and action. So for example, if you say, I'm sincerely trying to pass my exams, then you can only say you're being sincere if, number one, there's a proper intention, like you really feel that within yourself. But if you do have that intention, the next thing will be attention. You'll give the best part of your time to doing that. You'll make quality space in your life for pursuing that. And then the next thing is action. You'll actually put effort in. You'll put endeavor in. You'll put the hours in. And after all is said and done, once you've had the intention, the attention, and the action, which signifies sincerity, it's already a success. Then after that, if you get the highest grades or you don't, that's not what deems yourself successful. You're already a success because you tried your best. So, yeah, too much in the world, we base success on result, success on accomplishment, success on what happens at the end. But Krishna in the Bhagavad Gita says you can't control the result, the end, the accomplishment. But you can control your intention, your attention, and your action. And therefore in your life, like you bring up kids. Say for example you have kids in the future. You can't control your kids. How do you know? You have a vision. You want them to be in a certain way. But they have their own free will. But as a parent, you have the right intention. You give them the attention. And you do all the actions required. And after all is said and done, they have to go on their journey. But whatever they go and do on their journey, you're still a successful parent because you gave the best of yourself.
This just got me thinking about the interplay between spiritual life and mental health and well-being, because it seems as though spiritual life protects you against the highs and lows of life and the difficulties. So I was wondering, from your experience amongst the monks you meet and the people who are very involved in spiritual life, if they are exempt from mental health problems or more protected against them, from your experience?
Yeah, I'll kind of go back to what I said here earlier, that it's not that we don't have problems, it's not that even monks don't have mental health problems. To be honest, I think all of us have some of that. Some days you wake up and you just don't feel right, and you're kind of like, everything's all right, but I don't feel all right. That's just the mind, and we all have that struggle. So yeah, I think even monks, even spiritualists, I think they also have issues with mental health. It's what we're struggling with in this world. But as I said, I think we When we take up a spiritual path, we have a framework through which to see our mind. We are equipped with tools and practices which help us to then deal with the problems of the mind. And therefore, we're more equipped, as you said, to kind of respond to it in a progressive way. When you become a spiritualist, you don't identify with the mind, you identify the mind. You see? So spirituality helps you to step away from your mind and become an observer. And that changes the game. Because most people in the world don't have that perspective. Therefore, when the mind is, they think that's them. And they think that is me. I'm jumbled. I'm confused. No, you're just a person who has a jumbled up mind right now. You're just a person, a soul, who has a confused mind. But step away and you can work with it. The mind is like a browser. So imagine you have like Mozilla Firefox, right? The browser has a home page. The browser has a history. The browser has favorites. The browser has an autocomplete. So if you type www.a, boom, a whole lot of options come up where you've been before. So each of us have a mind which is like a browser. We have a default home page that we always go back to. We have history of experiences. We have favorites. We have things that trigger us to go in certain directions. But can you optimize a browser? Can you? Of course you can. You can change the home page. You can delete the history. You can add in new favorites. You can remove the cookies. So just like that, you can change the browser of your mind. But just like even when you optimize the browser, still you might get a pop-up. Can't predict those. So even after you've optimized your mind, still, boom, sometimes thoughts, things may come. But the spiritualist observes it. So the great art of life is to know how to optimize the browser of your mind. And that's what we're trying to share with the world, because people are trying to deal with mental health without an understanding of what the mind is. How are you going to solve mental health if you don't deeply understand the mechanics of the mind? And that's where spiritual literature comes in and gives such a elevated perspective.
Krishna is all pure, and we're part and parcel of Krishna. Where did our impurities come in, and how can we fall in from him? Is it down to our free will, or?
Yeah, thank you. So, by nature, we're spiritual beings and we're connected with the Supreme Spirit who's pure, so we are pure. So how does the pure spirit soul become contaminated or overcome by things like anger and so on and so forth? I guess there's two ways to answer that question. The first thing is that we never actually contaminated. We're always pure. Because the spirit soul, Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, cannot be withered by wind, cannot be cut by a sword, cannot be burned by fire. The soul is as it is, pure. But what happens is that the soul becomes covered by a mind. The soul becomes covered by a body. And with that mind and that body comes the then manifestation of material consciousness. So like, for example, there's this light here, and if you put a green shade around it, then it will come out as green light. But the original light is not green, it's just light. So consciousness is always pure, but when consciousness then comes through a material mind and body, then it comes out as lust, anger, greed, envy, pride. So your next question is then, why did we get that material mind and body? And that's because of free will. So because the pure soul wanted to experience the material world, Krishna equipped the pure soul with a material body and a material mind. So it's like if you want to go into space, you need a space suit. So if you want to come into the material world, you need a material mind and body. But when you get that material mind and body, then it comes out as green light. Then the consciousness comes out. But originally it's pure. Therefore, when we see people doing the wrong thing, we say, hate the disease, not the diseased. So it's not that... there's no such thing as a bad person. There's a good person who does bad things. No one's inherently bad. No one's inherently envious or angry. But we've picked these things up and now we're trying to shed those layers of superficiality. Oh, when we're in the womb. Wow, deep question. So it's said that the soul is moving from body to body. So say, for example, tomorrow I die and I haven't attained spiritual perfection, then what will happen is that this physical body will basically drop dead. And then what will happen is the soul will be carried by the mind to the next destination. So then what happens is, me, the soul, is carried by the mind, and immediately, it's said in the 13 days after you die, in that time the soul is making the journey, and according to your karma and your desires, you then enter the womb for your next phase of existence. Now what's interesting is it's said that when the soul moves into the womb, it remembers everything from its previous life. So you remember who you were, where you were, you're like, oh my God, like where am I now? I'm in the, and you realize, oh my God, I'm going into another life now. You remember all these things. And it's said actually in the Bhagavatam, these blue books here are the Bhagavatam, and in the third canto of the Bhagavatam, what is actually described is embryology. So the evolution of the embryo in the womb of the mother. And it's actually mentioned there that the soul actually prays that, you know, now I'm about to take birth into the material world again. I pray that I don't make the same mistakes again. So it's aware. But then what happens is it's said that at the time of birth, the experience of the soul coming into the world is such a traumatic experience that it basically resets the memory. Have you ever seen a child come out of the mother's womb like smiling, like, yeah, here I am? No, they come out crying. It's traumatic. Why does nature arrange for that traumatic experience and for the memory to be reset? Because unless your memory is reset, you can't function in this life. I mean, imagine being in this life and remembering everything of your previous life. It would be like identity crisis. So in order to function as a normal being and live out your desires, you have to forget the past. So divinity arranges for that to happen. And that's the journey of how a soul comes into this world. I see, you can... Okay, all right, yeah. So Srila Prabhupada, yeah, you're right, is a title. It can be offered to any eminent spiritual person. Srila Prabhupada is like, yeah, I guess it's something like the Archbishop of Canterbury, something like that, right? Like when someone accomplished who has been recognized by the community of spiritualists elevates themselves to a certain level of spiritual accomplishment, the community recognizes them to be like that eminent person. So Srila Prabhupada's own spiritual master was also known as Srila Prabhupada. And later on, because of Bhaktivedanta Swami's accomplishments in sharing spirituality around the world, the community recognized him to be worthy of the same title. So is your question, is someone in the future can have that? Is that your question?
Is it somebody in the present have that title?
Oh, yeah. So no one at present has that title. So we understand Srila Prabhupada to be... In the future, will someone have that title? Maybe. We can't say no for sure. But at present, yeah, no.
So we'll have Chitrapri, if you want to say the final question, and then...
How do we stop our spiritual practices from being mechanical?
How do we stop our spiritual practices from being mechanical? So I would say a few things. You know you're becoming mechanical when you don't give your spiritual practices priority, the priority time in your life, the best part of the day. You know you're becoming mechanical when you have no plan to increase your spiritual practices and no desire. You know you're becoming mechanical when you have no quality remembrance of the goal when you're doing your spiritual practices. You know you're becoming mechanical when you look for justifications and excuses not to do your spiritual practices. So I once wrote an article called The Mechanics of Spirituality. And in that I'd kind of discussed this whole thing. But in those symptoms of mechanical practice, you then also get the clues of how to turn it around. So if you do want to turn it around, then first thing is, give it the best time of your day. If you do want to turn it around, then have a vision for how you're going to do more, where you're going to do more. Maybe you can take a week in the year where you put everything to one side and you just focus on your spiritual practices to go deeper. If you want your spiritual practices to not be mechanical, then remember who you're doing it for, why you're doing it, what the purpose is. Always bring yourself back to the purpose behind it all. And if you want to avoid mechanical things, then try to avoid excuses not to do it and stay focused in the discipline. So yeah, if you do those things, then you won't become a spiritual robot. Thank you. I guess we're done.
Wonderful. Thank you all so much for your questions. I'm going to finish off on a final question, because after we conclude here, we're going to be going into the temple room to take darshan of the deities. They're the center of everything here. Everything revolves around those. So, Maharaj, if you'd like to say something maybe about the deities and what to expect when they go in there. And
Yeah, so you're going to go into the temple room. This is a very... It's a very spiritually surcharged place. I guess you could say it's the center of the whole temple. It's said that God is everywhere. So then why do we worship deities? Well, it's kind of like this. Water is everywhere, isn't it? Even in the atmosphere, there's water droplets. That's why... If we all start getting up, jumping and dancing, get really sweaty, then you'll see condensation because there's water in the atmosphere. Yet when you're thirsty, you can't just be like... I mean, although there's water there, in that form, it's not so accessible to you. When we're thirsty, we go to a tap because that's where water is accessible in its most concentrated form. So it said that when we want to access divinity, the divine person, in the most powerful way, then divinity appears in this world in the form of a deity. And by interacting with this deity in a spirit of devotion, in a very personal way, in a very sensitive way, and opening your heart and mind to transcendental reciprocation, you can actually experience a tangible relationship with the divine. And so we have the deities of Krishna here and the deities of Krishna's incarnations who you'll hear about. And it's we understand them to be the Supreme Person. It's not a representation, it's not an icon. No, this is the Supreme Divinity who has appeared in this way. And so every day we sing for them, every day we dress them, every day we feed them, every day we go to them and we offer our prayers and we ask questions. And in the beginning, you may go in front of them and it all may feel a little weird. It may feel a little, maybe even childish. It may even feel a little, mythological. But it's very, very powerful. It's an opening of the heart to connect with the divine. And so, experience it. Maybe when you go in front of Krishna, try it out. Say a prayer, open your heart, and see whether there's some reciprocation does come in your life. Every morning all of our services are in the temple. So yeah, soak in the vibration. Decades of meditation and chanting has gone on in there.